It's great to be together this morning. Thank you for being here despite the rain. You know how we are in California about rain? I don't know if I can make it. It's raining, you know? So I wanted to do this before I got into the sermon. I totally forgot to do this in the past couple of weeks, but we have a newly engaged couple in our fellowship here in the Greater Long Beach Church, and we haven't been able to announce it here, but I wanted us to celebrate with our awesome campus and teen ministry intern, DK Ezinekwe, and his new fiance, Marissa Garcia, here. They got engaged. You can stand up. You get a picture and the live couple right there. But on New Year Day, they got engaged. She said yes, and we have the evidence right there. I'm sorry, Marissa, I stole this off of your Facebook. You know, is that okay? It's public property, I'm assuming, so. But I'm so excited for DK and Marissa. They're going to get married here probably in the June. She's about to finish college in May, so she'll kind of walk across the stage, get her diploma, change into her dress, and get down the aisle, you know? That's awesome. Really proud of them and excited for them. We're going to continue our series here, Tough as Nails. And the title of the lesson today is Fixing Our Eyes. And I just want to, before I say this, you know, I did get a lot of positive response from the lesson last week. And so if you didn't get a chance to listen to it, please join our podcast. You can go to our podcast or you can go on our online at our website and try to find it there. But I do want to give credit where credit's due. You know, sometimes throughout the year, I listen to other preachers and other lessons, and I realize, this would really be good for the congregation here in Greater Long Beach. And so this actually, a lot of the material here comes from a church called the North Point Community Church, and the pastor there is Andy Stanley. It's a church outside of our fellowship of churches, but a lot of the material here and even this video that we're showing, I got it from them, and it's just the content was so rich and good, and I felt, man, this would be so appropriate for the fellowship here in Greater Long Beach. And so, you know, thank you for the encouraging words last week, but this, a lot of the credit goes to the material I received from North Point Community Church. So I just wanted to say that before we get into this, okay? All right, we're ready. You know, I so love the songs that we got to sing today. They tie in so well with what we're going to be talking about today in the Bible, and they tie in so well with our whole theme, that uncertainty is unavoidable, but to be fearful in that uncertainty is optional. And even that song, Whom Shall I Fear, that we sang, we had the God of angel armies on our side. And it was cool, as we're singing the song, I know we prayed earlier for our brother, our dear brother, Kevin Maines, and for those who don't know Kevin used to actually be here and lead the Greater Long Beach Ministry and was in Palos Verdes leading the South Bay Ministry and now is leading the Orange County region and just has done such a great servant of the Lord throughout our fellowship of churches. And my dad's here, and my dad's in his region, and my dad whispered over to me, that's Kevin's favorite song, the Whom Shall I Fear? So it's kind of cool how the Spirit moved and just we're singing his favorite song here at church today. And anyway, I just thought it was neat. What should people think when they hear the word Christian? If you're a Christian here, what do you think people should think when they hear the word Christian? In fact, if you're not a Christian and you're here because somebody dragged you out of your bed to be here, or you met a pretty girl in the church and you said, I want to see that pretty girl again, or you know, you said made a New Year's resolution that this is my year, I'm going to start going back to church. I don't know why you're here or whatever, but if you're not a Christian or if you've been outside of the Christians, what comes to mind to you when you think of the word Christian? And last week, we talked about this word, fearless. And we said that the founder of our faith was a man who walked right into Jerusalem and faced pain and death head on, and that his followers, his people that followed him, imitated and reflected this fearlessness. They didn't fear death. They didn't fear illness. They didn't fear loss. And we're still talking about them thousands of years later. This is his people. Fearless. But I wonder if that comes to mind to those who are not Christian when they hear the word Christian. You know, another word we sort of talked about was the word confidence. That the Christian is fearless because we're following a fearless Savior. And if you don't fear loss, what should be said about us is that we are even more selfless. Because if you don't fear losing anything, you're more selfless, you're more generous, you're more compassionate. And then this word confidence. Not an arrogant, like, I got this confidence. Not that. But a genuine amount of confidence because of Jesus and his example. Able to, as the proverb writer describes, I love this phrase, the proverb writer in Proverbs 31 describes a woman of noble and a wife of noble character, and he uses this phrase that she's able to laugh at the days to come. And although that proverb specifically talks about a wife of noble character, should that not describe the Christian? That no matter what the circumstance, no matter what's happening in our lives, we should be able to be confident and in a way laugh at the days to come. Because of our faith in God, our strong trust in the promises of Christ. These people in the first century were sure about the things that really mattered. There was something so positive about the Christian that those outside of the Christian circle in the first and second century would look at these people and wonder, how did they get this way? They'd see them in the stadiums, in the arenas, getting mauled by animals. And people would just wonder, out of curiosity, these people are so fearless. They're so confident. How is that possible? See, a Christian is a follower of Christ, right? It's somebody who follows Christ. And if you're a follower of Christ, you should look like Christ, but Christ did not look like this. It's like what we talked about last week. Christ did not look like this. This guy could not walk into Jerusalem with confidence and fearlessness after praying about it, God, let your will be done, not mine, walking in there and saying, I'm ready. I don't think that guy could have done it. See, he was not fragile, and therefore Christianity is not fragile. So his followers should not be fragile either. So my big question to us today is, what is wrong with us? Or better yet, what went wrong with us? Christianity in the first century was irresistible. Something so unique about the Christian and the people there that people outside of that circle were attracted to this group because of their fearlessness and their confidence, even though there was so much to fear. And these people outside of the Christian circle would just wonder, I can't wait for the Christian to arrive. I don't know what they do eating that bread and drinking that wine. I don't understand all that. They're talking about some dude that some Jewish carpenter that raised from, I don't get it, but their lives, their faith, their fearlessness, their confidence. Man, I want to be around them a little bit more. So why is it that when people in our society today hear the word Christian, they don't think of someone who is fearless or confident? They think of somebody self-righteous, judgmental, hypocritical. That's a big one. And so some of you stop coming to church and going to church because of how a Christian treated you. Some of you say, I will never work for a Christian ever again. Some of you will say, I don't want to, if our neighbors are Christian, I am not going to be around them. Because in our society, for some reason, the word Christian does not elicit that description. Why did we lose our reputation as the fearless ones the confident ones. Why is it that during the meltdown of an economy or a change in the political environment, Christians are the ones freaking out? Why are we so worried? Jesus, our Savior, who walked into Jerusalem to face death and shame, would look at us and say, "What? What are you so afraid of? Have you forgotten who you follow? And you're worried about what? You're scared of who?" Today, we're going to study this amazing passage in Scripture. Turn our Bibles here to Hebrews 11. It's kind of cool. We sang the song about by faith, you know, all these different people by faith. And we're going to read some excerpts here in 11, chapter 11 and chapter 12. And if you have a Bible, please follow along. If not, you can follow along on the screen with us here. But the author of Hebrews, we're not really sure who it was. But this book, this letter was written to Jewish Christians who are beginning to wonder, under persecution and being mistreated, they were beginning to wonder, is it worth it? Is it worth it? I'm being imprisoned. My wife got taken from me. My husband got taken from me. What is it worth it? And they were beginning to wonder, is it working? These small gatherings of people who believed Jesus was the Son of God, based on countless witnesses and letters being, you know, mailed around and these kind of things, but they had no idea, no unified plan to evangelize the world. They had no idea if it was going to spread around the world. So is it really working? Are we making a difference? And so the writer, the author, spends his time talking about Jesus and the sovereignty, the lordship, the godliness, the righteousness of Jesus. And he gets to Hebrews 11 in verse 1, and he says, "Now faith is confidence of what and what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see." This is right here the biblical definition of faith. In fact, this is the definition of faith that you live out without even knowing it sometimes. You don't call it faith. You call it a paycheck. Because anybody here who has been offered a job or has worked a job understands when you get offered that job, you are promised a paycheck. At the end of the amount of hours or the end of the project or whatever, you're offered that. And so you work diligently with confidence that at the end of that time, you will receive what has been promised. See, you don't even know sometimes. You live by faith every day. The writer here, the author of Hebrews, describes it, and he says, that's what faith is. You're certain. You're sure. You're confident in what you hope for and about what you do not see. And then he continues in verse 2, and he says, now, this is what the ancients were commended for. And then what he does is so cool. I encourage you this week to read this on your own. But he goes through a list of people in the Old Testament. Again, he's talking to Jewish Christians. So all these people know who these people are. He's talking about Abraham and Moses and Noah and Enoch and all these different people, characters from the Old Testament that even if you grew up in church and had been around church, you've heard these names before. All who were commended for their faith, their confidence, and assurance in God's promise. See, because faith is being confident that someone is going to keep their promise. They're going to do what they promised to do. And walking by faith is living as if God can be trusted and that God is going to keep his promise. All these people in verse 3 were still living by faith when they died. They did not receive the things promised. They only saw them and welcomed them from a distance. Oh, am I 13? I'm sorry. Verse 13. Skipping down after he talks to all those people. Verse 13. All these people were still living by faith when they died. They did not receive the things promised. They only saw them and welcomed them from a distance. These people died without ever seeing the promise fulfilled. Think about that. They didn't get the paycheck, but they worked hard and lived faithfully, believing that God would fulfill his promise. God promised Abraham. What was the promise? God promised Abraham that he was going to make his descendants into a great nation, and that the whole world, all peoples, all nations, would be blessed through him, through this nation. Abraham did not see that happen. His son Isaac didn't see it happen. His grandson Jacob didn't see it happen. Moses didn't see it happen. Generation after generation after generation did not see that promise fulfilled, and yet there was always a core group of people who lived on this other side of the promise, of God's promise, but are commended because they did not lose faith. They walked faithfully with God. They believed that he would come through someday. This is so convicting to you and me. Because we pray something on Monday, and if God doesn't show up, it doesn't happen by Friday, we doubt the existence of God. God, I know I just prayed for a date. I know it's not a big deal to you, God. But if he doesn't ask me by Friday, I'm done. This is how we get. And they would look at us, these ancients would look at us and say, we waited our whole lives trusting God and didn't see the promise, but trusted him anyway. And you're mad about what? You're complaining about what? And in verse 36, you keep on reading, because it kind of takes a break, and he talks about this in verse 13. And then he talks about some more people. And then later on in the chapter here in verse 36, it says, some faced jeers and flogging and even chains and imprisonment. They were put to death by stoning. They were sawed in two. They were killed by the sword. They went about in sheepskins and goatskins, destitute, persecuted, and mistreated. And then I can just imagine the author, as he's writing this, he kind of looks up, probably thinking about his complaints, probably thinking about the discipling time he had the other day where this brother was complaining about what small group he was in, probably thinking about another brother who was imprisoned because in that time you got imprisoned and you got persecuted, and he's wondering, is it worth it? Is it working? And as he's thinking about Moses, as he's thinking about Moses' mom, putting a three-month-old baby in a little basket, trusting that God was going to take care of her baby. As he thinks about Abraham taking his son up to the mountain, willing to sacrifice his son because he believed so much in the promise of God. As he starts considering all these people, he writes something that I want to stick with us for the rest of our week this week, but the rest of our lives. As he considers these people, he says, the world was not worthy of them. The world was not worthy of them. There was once a version of faithfulness to God that elicited and required heroic living, that caused people to stand back and wonder, who are these people? That caused people to be so impressed they couldn't keep their eyes off these people. The most awe-inspiring, fearless, and confident people they'd ever met. And they were rich and poor. And they were masters and slaves. And there were men and women and children and Jews and Gentiles. And it grew and it grew and it grew. And it's the reason you and I are here today. Because there was once a version of faithfulness, of a people that was awe-inspiring. And the world wasn't worthy of them. And the author keeps on pushing the issue. He says, these were all commended, verse 39, for their faith. Yet none of them, he says it again, yet none of them, just in case you didn't hear it the first time, yet none of them received what had been promised. And here's where we come in. Because God, since God had planned something better for us, so that only together with us would they be made perfect. See, God was up to something so big, so huge, so awesome, literally awesome, so international, that we, you and I, are now thousands of years later here talking about it. He says, they didn't receive what was promised because God had something better in store for us. Because everything that happened led up to this Jewish carpenter being crucified and God raising him from the dead. Salvation. A new chance. A new people. Not just a nation, not just a geographic nation now, a new people of all nations gathered together. His promise was better for us. And they were made, these ancients who died without receiving the promise, were made complete, perfect, complete, matured by God's amazing promise. See, to summarize this, they were looking forward and were faithful. They didn't see what was, they saw it from a distance, but they were looking forward and were faithful. And you and I, we're looking back and are fearful. We look back and are fearful. The writer says it's already happened. You've received a way better promise than even Abraham. And you're fearful? You and I, we have no reason to be fearful. We should be the most fearless, confident, and humble people, not because of something God has promised, but because of something God has already done. We are on the other side of the promise. And so he says, therefore, because of this, therefore, since we're surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, since we're surrounded by this incredible cloud of witnesses from the Old Testament, all these people who did not receive the promise and yet stayed faithful. And then for you and I, we have a cloud of witnesses from the New Testament. We have the apostles, the first century church in the book of Acts, all the letters that were written. We're the second century disciples who were being persecuted by different emperors. We have evidence. We have all these stories, all this evidence, historical evidence of the faithfulness of these men and women because of these cloud of witnesses. Here's what I want you to do. Let us hide, whine, complain, hoard our resources just in case, put our Bibles in a drawer, build bomb shelters, purchase ammunition, blame the cops, blame the president, blame the economy, blame the teachers, blame our parents, demand our rights, build a wall, tax the rich, play it safe, find somebody to sue, take back our country, and pray that Jesus returns so that we won't have to suffer. Did I miss anybody? Can you imagine how we sound to this cloud of witnesses? Can you imagine how we must sound to Christians who are in Syria or in Iraq or in Yemen? You're worried about what? You're nervous about that? You're anxious about what? I don't get it. Please explain it to me. What would they say about our prayers? This cloud of witnesses. God, keep me safe today. Help me find a job. Help me get a date. Help my kids get into that school. God, help me, help me, help me, help me, help me. My genie in the bottle, help me. What? How embarrassing it would be if some of these cloud of witnesses would hear some of us pray. That's it? That's all you're praying about? Do you have any idea the price people had to pay in order for you to know Christ? For this faith to pass on generation to generation? Do you know? And you're praying to get a date? There's nothing wrong with specific prayer, but is that it? You don't have anything bigger for God? You don't have anything outrageous for God? Is it worth it? Is it working? And here's what he says. Here's what he actually says. When Christianity is in decline or under attack, or why isn't it like the good old days? Or why aren't Christians dating the way they should? Or why don't people listen to us? Is it worth it? Is it working? Here's what he says. He says, because of this great crowd of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. Instead of pointing the finger and blaming others, look at yourself and ask, what is holding me back? Why am I not all in? What is the sin that is entangling me? Because, you see, the darker the world gets, the brighter the light shines. The more uncertainty there is, the more faith there should be. What is it that you're scared about, really? Who is it that you're afraid of, really? What is hindering you from embracing uncertainty and moving into it with fearlessness? I considered this as I was praying about this week. And in knowing my character and knowing kind of my sinful nature, I realized a lot of times, and this may not be necessarily a sin, but a lot of times I can be entangled and hindered by my own insecurity of what other people think of me. Does that make sense? And so I think as a leader, this can be a challenge. I make a decision or I say something and I hope they took it okay. I hope they like me. And so instead of embracing the uncertainty, instead of embracing the eventual maybe conflict and approaching it with fearlessness and confidence and humility, I may not say what needs to be said. Or I may not do what needs to be done. Because I care more about what people think and being liked than about what's right to God. It's what keeps my mouth shut sometimes when I'm at the restaurant. When I could invite that waiter to church to study the Bible. It's what keeps my mouth shut when I see somebody in sin that needs to be challenged. Oh, they'll figure it out. Give them time. You guys hear me on this? This is real for me. It hinders. It entangles. Look at yourself. What is it that's entangling you? What is it that's hindering you from living a life without fear, full of faith, confident, inspired by these men and women who went before us? It says, then let us run with perseverance. Meaning you don't back down, you don't give up, you don't throw in the towel. You run with perseverance. This race marked out for us, for our generation. You know, you and I, we have something very specific to do. A culture very specific to reach. A very specific race to run. And the question will always be, will we run? Or will we join the complaining bandwagon, the fearful, the faithless, the blame shifters? The challenge for us will always be, will we throw off everything and join in with those who came before us and live fearless, confident lives? And the author says, you know, while you're running your race with perseverance, fix your eyes on, and fill in the blank there. What are your eyes fixed on right now? We fix our eyes on security, on safety, on who we can blame for our circumstances. Many times our eyes are fixed on the wrong thing. We fix our eyes on the faults of the church. We fix our eyes on how they mistreated me in the church and how that person didn't give me a hug and they gave me a wrong look. We fix our eyes on, you know, how come I can't be in a discipling partnership with that person? How come I can't? Why is the church always talking about money? We fix our eyes on the wrong things. And as long as our eyes are fixed there, we will not run with perseverance or endurance. We will live scared and fearful and faithless, and we will miss our opportunity in this generation to do our best to change the world. What are your eyes fixed on today? Author says you got to fix your eyes on Jesus, right? It says the pioneer. Some translation, you know, the older translation says the author. The pioneer, the beginning, the founder, and perfecter. He fulfilled the promise of our faith. He becomes the focus. How would Jesus respond to this? What would Jesus do in this situation? How would Jesus talk to this person? Remembering the whole time that they didn't have to go find him, he walked into the jaws of death and said, "Follow me," calling us to a life of fearlessness and confidence. I'll tell you, it changed the world once. Can you imagine if we actually began to live this way on a daily basis? Could it not change the world again? But not if we're afraid. Fixing your eyes on Jesus. Yeah, sure, help the political process, go protest, do whatever you're going to do, but that's not the focus. Fixing your eyes on Jesus. He's not done. He keeps on going. He says, "For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame." You know, we talked about this last week. And again, listen to the sermon from last week. We talked about this last week, how crucifixion was not about death. It was about shame. Shaming the prisoner. And Jesus, author says here that Jesus scorned its shame, despised its shame, and he sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Jesus understood the shame. He grew up seeing bodies hanging, hearing it, smelling it, and he walked right into it and says, "Follow me." Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. The author's getting fired up right now as he's considering all these people, as he's considering all the persecution, as he's considering not just the people, but Jesus. He says, consider him. So that you, as you're enduring your race with perseverance, won't grow weary and lose heart. Can I provide two challenges for us today? Two groups of people I want to talk to. I want to talk to those of you who are over 45. With all due respect, my elder brethren. Because I'm younger than you. I want to speak to the over 45-year-olds, and I'll say this with all respect and humility. Many of you have grown weary and lost heart. Many of you are fixing your eyes on the political system or economy or the good old days, and you're worried about your retirement and your mortgage and what laws are being passed and what policies are being made and why we sing those songs and not the old songs and how come God didn't answer my prayer all these years and fulfill what I was so sure was my dream, and you're so worried and anxious and why isn't the church growing like it used to and how come we're not reaching all nations and you're scaring the children. The generation right after you is coming up, and what we need are men and women of faith. Men and women who approach the political system, the racial tension, social media, the economy, job losses, unemployment, whatever. We need men and women who approach all of that uncertainty with fearlessness and faith. Fixing your eyes on Jesus and modeling faith for the next generation that God is in control. I'm so thankful that we have so many great examples in the church of this. I appreciate so much Miles and Timmy Branson. Miles and Timmy have been disciples for a long time, been Christians for a long time. And they said, you know what, we want to spend, you know, we're empty nesters now, we want to spend our time helping the next generation. We're going to be in the singles ministry. Serving, shepherding, giving. Well, then Rick and Donna Mark caught the bug too, and they're like, hey, we want to serve as shepherds too. Because we're empty nesters, and we're going to get in there, and we want to help the next generation and be a model of faith for the next generation. Well, then Nestor retired, Sosa, and Linda, Sosa, and we said, hey, well, what about you guys? Do you want to go help the next generation too? And they said, okay, we're going to use our time and our efforts and our energy and our heart to shepherd in the singles ministry, to be examples and model faith for the next generation. I'm just lifting up these couples because, you know, there's so many here in the church. I'm not, you know, oh, now my eyes are fixed on Reuben didn't say my name. No, listen. I know there are plenty of examples here, but I'm always inspired by their faith because they're saying, listen, I'm gonna sacrifice this, a little bit of this comfort here, so that I can help other people and be a model of faith to the next generation. Recently, last week even, I announced this to the campus ministry. I'm going to share it here. Might as well. The Holy Spirit's leading. As we're taking leaps of faith in the church, as we're jumping and we're trying to do things and shake things up a little bit so that we can reach more people and grow, we asked our awesome campus ministry and teen ministry intern, DK Ezenekwe. He said, hey, bro, we need you to go into the singles ministry and leave the campus and serve in the singles ministry. Singles are like, what? Yes. So we announced it this past Wednesday at Campus Midweek. DK is actually going to be transitioning into the singles ministry. This is part of continuing to train him as he works with adults and working professionals, these kind of things. But he's going to be partnering with Stephen and helping to lead the singles ministry. I am so excited about this, okay? Now, that's not what I really wanted to talk about because he's in the next point about the under 40, 45, okay? But I wanted to share this. This is amazing. So we said, you know, there's a need in shepherding in the campus ministry. And Brian and Karen Plymel have done a heroic job being mom and dad to the campus ministry for many years. Amen? And they're using their faith, their empty nester years, to pass the faith on to the next generation, to be models of faith to the next generation, but they need some help. So I said, Greg, who do you want? Greg made the big ask. He said, I want Papa Joe. So I said, okay, I mean, you don't get it if you don't ask, right? So I'll go ask. I don't think you're going to get him, but I'll go ask. We met with Papa Joe and Sarah. We said, hey, bro, there's a need in the campus ministry. They would love for you to come in and serve in the campus ministry as shepherds. You know what Papa Joe said after wrestling with it a little bit? He said, bro, where's the need? Put me there. I'll go help in. I'll go help out. And so I'm excited. Joe and Sarah are going to transition into the campus ministry to partner with Brian and Karen and shepherding in the campus ministry. Models of faith. Examples of faith for the next generation. Sarah just retired. Papa Joe is going to retire next month, at the end of February, God willing. And that's awesome. So they're going to be up on campus sharing their faith. No, I'm just kidding. You know. But they're going to be in the campus. I'm so excited about this. Let me talk to you who are under 45. Do not grow weary and lose heart. It is worth it. It is working. Don't fix your eyes on social media. Don't fix your eyes on Washington, D.C. Because once upon a time, there was a generation our age who embraced a fearless Savior and His teachings, and they changed the world. And they did it through faith and a behavior that reflects that faith. So you're a college student. You're a high school student. Don't give up. Don't lose heart and grow weary. So you're a newlywed. You're a new parent. You're coming out of the fog. Don't grow weary and lose heart. You're a young parent who's raising preteens and teenagers. Don't grow weary and lose heart. You're a single professional who's being inundated, flooded with temptations on a daily basis, saying that marriage is the standard and you need to reach that standard and then you'll be happy. Don't grow weary and lose heart. But the author is not done. I just wish he were done, but he's not. He pushes it a little bit more. And he says, in your struggle against sin, you have not resisted to the point of shedding your blood. So just take that, just put that in your back pocket for the week. You are on the other side of the promise. You have every reason in the world to be fearless, every reason in the world to be confident, every reason in the world to be generous, every reason in the world to be compassionate. So step up and step in. People who don't consider Jesus will consider him because of your fearlessness and how you live your life. Imagine a generation of which it was considered and written later on. Man, I remember those Christians from 2017. The world was not worthy of them. Would you like to be part of that generation? Would you in the back there, would you like to be part of that generation? Would you over here, would you guys like to be part of that generation? I would. It doesn't matter who the president is. It doesn't matter if we're able to capture the good old days. It doesn't matter what happens to the economy. We have the chance to run the race marked out specifically for us. And it happens when we stop being afraid and start living with confidence that God is for us, not against us. Imagine a generation where when people thought of the word Christian, they think of the most awesome, hardworking, generous, fearless, confident people I've ever met. I'm glad I get to work for a Christian. I'm glad I hired a Christian. I'm glad my daughter's dating a Christian. I'm glad that my son has Christian friends. Can you imagine? People will be so fired up when the Christians come to work, when the Christian moves in next door. So secure, so fearless, the world was not worthy of them. And some were Republican, and some were Democrat, and some were wealthy, some were not so wealthy, and some were married, and some were not, and some were single parents, and some were in blended families, but they all followed the same fearless Savior. And in the end, they were just Christians. They were just Christians. So do not throw away your confidence. It will be richly rewarded. You need to persevere, so that when you have done the will of God, you will receive what he has promised. And the author quotes two Old Testament verses here. For in just a little while, he who is coming will come and will not delay. And the other one, but my righteous one will live by faith, and I take no pleasure in the one who shrinks back. But we, you and I, this generation of Christians, do not belong to those who shrink back and are destroyed, but to those who have faith and are saved. Uncertainty, unavoidable. Fearful, optional. Our Savior walked in to the jaws of death, and he says, follow me. and that generation of Christians, the author of Hebrews says, man, that the world's not even worthy of these people. The ancients who lived by faith without receiving what was promised, the world was not worthy of them. So is it worth it? And is it working? He says, don't throw away your confidence. Don't shrink back. Have faith. Let's pray for our communion at this time. Father, thank you so much for your word, the guidance that your word provides, the inspiration your word provides. Thank you for Jesus who walked in to death, knowing full well what was going to happen to him, and the conviction to call us to follow him. That we would complain about suffering, that we would complain about uncertainty, makes no sense to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ because of his example. Thank you that you always provide a way out, that you always provide a way to step up, to step in. God, thank you so much for your grace, your compassion, your mercy. As we take the bread that represents the body of Christ, help us to remember how his body was beaten, flogged. And thousands of years later, we're not talking about the Roman centurions who did it. We're not talking about Pilate. We're talking about Jesus because of his body that was beaten for us. As we take the cup that represents the blood of Christ, help us to evaluate what is the sin that is easily or whatever it is that's entangling us, hindering us from being all in as disciples of Jesus Christ. Thank you for this time. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.